welcome to Actors Anonymous Podcast. I am your host, Wissam Keesh. Co-hosting with me is Jordan Burbank.
I can't hear you. And these are broken.
Great way to start the first episode of 2016 with some broken headphones. Is it plugged in?
No.
It's not plugged in. It's all right.
It's okay. Oh, wait, it is.
It is plugged in.
I'm done. Anyway, so...
Riveting.
Yeah.
Riveting podcast start right now.
That's what I have Nicole for.
Jordan, how were your holidays?
My holidays were great. Mm-hmm. They were very long, and I am back in L.A.
That's awesome to hear. I have to make a confession to our listeners why we didn't start at the very beginning of the year. There was, you know, that whole El Chapo thing that's going on. I was actually there with Mr. Sean Penn, and things were getting, you know, pretty heated, obviously. And, you know, we want to apologize to our listeners for...
Are you being prosecuted for interviewing?
Oh, they're questioning us, but, you know, they don't have a lot on us.
That's great. I'm happy for you.
Thank you. With us in the studio today is a great group of people, and one of them who's been on the show before, interns of F.I.E.L.D. with Jonathan Lipnicki, Joe Burke, and Benita Robledo. Robledo. There we go. I tried to do it the correct way, but I failed.
You're so confident in getting that right.
Right?
A for effort.
Thanks for coming on the show, guys.
Thank you for having us.
Interns of F.I.E.L.D. Great project. It's on Screenjunkies, correct?
Yes.
And we were just talking about this a little bit earlier, but how long did it take you guys to film this again?
We shot the whole thing in 12 days. Eight episodes in 12 days.
Wow. Yeah. That is super, super quick.
Yeah, it was, you know, it was definitely, it was a great learning experience. I feel as an actor, when you get the chance to have to be forced to make quick decisions on what you're going to do and only have a few takes to do everything, you come out stronger.
So tell us a little bit about Interns of F.I.E.L.D. and what it is.
So if you're familiar with Marvel's Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., it's kind of a parody on that, right? So we take the superhero world and the agents kind of make it procedural. Mm-hmm. And then the interns make it even more procedural. So it's all the like really boring, mundane things that you'd have to do, but it's in the superhero world. So it's, you know, it's just... rife with comedy.
When you guys started shooting, did you guys get all of the scripts all at once, or was it kind of like
It was written 90-page script. It was like a feature almost, but broken into, you know, obviously chapters. But it was basically like a feature script. You read it like a feature script. We shot it like a 12-day feature sort of. But yeah, it was all written. It was great.
Really great.
It actually ended up being 101 pages, Joe.
Was it? Did it be 101
pages? It was 101 pages. Just so we give ourselves more credit.
Yeah.
So we really did a lot in 12 days.
And I mean, that's including shots that had special effects in them. And it was awesome because we got really tight. So then when we had to do a scene, you know, a few days in, we're like, boom, 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 because you start to get really tight with people that you're working long hours with. And just our rapport was great as far as you know, working together, and just also they're fun to be around. So.
Well, nice.
It was a blast.
Shucks.
Any night shoots?
Not really.
No.
We started early every day, right?
Yeah, we started really early every day.
All interiors. shot a studio south of downtown in Vernon, that's called?
Vernon.
And it was all, 7 to 7 days.
Yeah.
And it was great.
Well, it just amazes me how many different, like the comic book and the superhero world and TV and film is just exploding. I mean, have you guys watched The Flash or Arrow? Any of those on the CW?
Yes.
I haven't seen those. I'm like halfway through Jessica Jones.
Jessica Jones.
I love Jessica Jones. It's so good. It's such a unique version of superheroes. It like goes into like a way more realistic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of like Daredevil?
Yeah, you know, they're supposed to be, isn't that, what's that called? The Defenders of S.H.I.E.L.D. or something? Or no, the Defenders. I think it's just called the Defenders instead of the Avengers. And they're like street people. That sounds really bad. People of the night. No, I think they're just like, they're on the lower level civilian side of fighting crime.
Right.
But I think it's Daredevil, her, and Luke Cage. I don't know. I'm not that much of a nerd. Like, side of like the
superheroes. I love like dark characters and dark stories, and I love how a lot of the comic book and superhero themed movies and TV shows are going into more real, gritty, and like really dark characters. one of my, I'm comparing like one of the first Supermans to the new trailer that I saw for, what is it, Superman versus Batman, right?
Yeah.
Or Batman versus Superman. Oh my gosh. That looks so intense. We actually have Jason Inman, who...
From DC. I was so bad at that.
DC Comics? No, not DC Comics.
DC Comics. It's the web channel, the DC exclusives or something. Mm-hmm. I just ran into him the other day.
Anyway, yeah, he got like, to see it, or he knew some of the stuff about it. He's like, it gets really dark, so I'm like super stoked for that.
I'm glad that there's something actually parroting like all this though.
Yeah,
like it's about time because it's like one of those things that there's just so much. It's just everywhere. There's so much Marvel and DC stuff mm-hmm. all over the place. It's finally good to see someone making fun of it.
do you guys prefer the old type of superhero films, or do you like the more lighter side or the more dark side?
I like the dark stuff personally. I mean, I totally get why it's everywhere right now. You know, I think a lot of people feel like we're living in a scary time, and mm-hmm. and a lot of things are changing, and I think it's a great outlet and kind of a fantasy that people can play out. Like, yeah, you know, if only we had these sort of powers, or there was someone out there, you know, I think it kind of plays into that. So yeah, I like dark and gritty.
Yeah. I think also people can call out bullshit now more days. That's not a word.
Nowadays.
Yeah. They can call like bullshit on whenever something's like, that's not real, or that seems kind of fake, or in terms of performance wise. So.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, the two that really stuck out to me, I mean, I've not seen all of them. And I'll say it up front, but the first Iron Man with Robert Downey Jr. was just like really changed the game for me. Where I just like the humor they brought and the tone of it, like, and then the effects and Jon Favreau directing that, and just like the Iron Man really set the tone of like, wow, like I could get into superhero movies, and I've enjoyed more. And then what Christopher Nolan did with The Dark Knight, obviously Heath Ledger's performance of the Joker, and kind of just the direction they took that was just jaw dropping for me. So those are my two favorite, you know, and Iron Man's a little lighter, a little funnier. Robert mm-hmm. Downey Jr. brings his humor, and it's a great sarcastic, you know, character. And then you go Dark Knight, and you do Heath Ledger, who's just a very, very, you know, troubled man character, and obviously a role that got the best of him maybe a little bit, but both sides of the spectrum a little bit, but both great performances and great dedication, I guess.
I love that there's such fantastical situations, and they've brought it down to something where we can watch it and easily suspend our disbelief for like an hour and a half. You know what I mean? Like, it's like, okay. In like the world of like, let's say, Christopher Nolan's The Dark Knight. If you read the script and you're like, wow, this is pretty fantastical, especially like with the third film with, did you watch the third one?
Dark Knight Rises?
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm.
I did. I did not care for it at all, but.
Okay.
Too much.
Oh, really? Okay.
Well, I mean.
Sorry.
No, it's fine.
He's in a hole trying to escape out of this hole across the ocean, another country, wherever he's in this little hole. Yeah. And then literally cuts to, he's now back in Gotham walking down the street. Is Batman. Yeah. And you're kind of, you may have, what? And then like, I already didn't like it, but then like, when that cut happened, I was kind of like, it's time to go home. Like, it's time to leave.
Ah.
Go home, Dark Knight, you're drunk.
Go home, you're drunk. but the Dark Knight is fantastic. I mean, Heath Ledger, to see an Oscar-winning performance. Did Nicholson win the Oscar too for the Joker back in the day? I know he got nominated, but did he win for the Tim Burton one? I can't remember.
I don't think he did.
He did not win? Okay.
Yeah.
All the Suicide Squad's apparently, what's his face?
Jared Leto?
Jared Leto's doing really good with that.
Yeah, well, we'll see. I mean, it's such an interesting character for an actor to take on such an interesting dark role, but like what Heath Ledger did with that character and what Nolan did with that, it's just like changed the game in terms of like, I mean, it's such a great performance in a superhero movie or whatever you want to call it, but
yeah,
just so rich and deep and dark and.
Well, I want to get back to that, but real quick, Jonathan, do you prefer the darker stuff or
I love Michael Fassbender as Magneto. You know, talking about, I mean, I know it's not Marvel, but talking about superhero. Wait, X-Men.
It
is Marvel. My bad. Sorry, guys. Early in the morning. Magneto. Michael Fassbender as Magneto. I always thought, as far as dark characters for me, I'm a huge fan of what he does with that. Mm-hmm. We're talking about great performances in.
I always forget how many movies. I mean, Guardians of the Galaxy was Marvel, in which that blew me away. I love Guardians of the Galaxy. So you kind of
see that. Well, it's so great. That's a great blend of having really great performances, funny, heartfelt. I mean, it kind of touched on everything. It was a movie with a lot of heart.
Tons of heart.
And I think that's maybe. You know, I'm sure like the lighter movies and sort of the classic movies, you know, they've got their own, you know, sense of nostalgia and the great things about them for sure. But But oh yeah, Guardians of the Galaxy. Yeah. Oh.
It's very self-aware. Like they make like mm-hmm. their own jokes about themselves, but in like a, I don't know. They don't break the fourth wall, but it does have like.
Well, they're all broken characters too. I guess maybe that happens a lot in these superhero movies. But like, that's why they're so relatable, right? Because all the characters are like kind of broken and hurt and have their own problems, and like it's very humanizing almost to see a superhero. He's a superhero, but he's still got problems like the rest of us. And I think that's why we love him.
Well, then I'm going to ask this question to you guys because there's a bigger point I'm trying to reach. Why do you think we connect with the newer movies that are coming out that are more dark, more gritty, more quote unquote real? Better,
like, well, give us an example of what movie you're talking. Like, what are you referring to? Like,
how? Okay, since we are talking about it, Dark Knight, not Rises,
Dark Knight,
The Dark Knight, yeah, sure. Dark Knight Rises, Heath Ledger's performance as the Joker. Why was everybody so just holy shit? Like,
do you mean
whoa.
In comparison to like the older Batman movies?
Yeah, let's compare that
to Jack Nicholson.
Both were good.
Oh, yeah.
And in their own respects, you know, and they were doing, you could say, different styles. But why are we more connected with Heath Ledger's?
Well, I think it just goes back to this idea of, like, the time we live in now, right? Mm. Like, we've spent how many years at war, right? We're dealing with really serious, really global problems. And I think that we don't have a lot of experience with that. Like, that still feels very new to us to have to worry about what's happening in other parts of the world, right? Like, we're now so interconnected. And I think that's frightening for people. And so mm-hmm. being able to see that on screen, but in a way that, you know, we see characters that are scared and broken like us, but then at the end prevail. Like, I think that gives us hope. And I think that's why we enjoy it so much.
Yeah, I mean, Heath Ledger really humanized the Joker. I mean, you really feel like he's just a kid who was abused by his dad growing up, and like, or stepdad. You know, I don't know the whole backstory that well, but you feel like he's a kid that was abused, that like his life got the best of him, and now he's sort of like just a crazy guy doing his shit. And it's just like, it's not like there's no wings to the camera. You know, it's a very dark, real person who got some serious issues who wants to hurt people.
Right.
And why are we, I don't know. I mean, why are we so attracted to that? I don't know. I mean, making a murderer is like, you know, a huge, I think just like seeing real life drama, craziness is something that's captivating.
John,
I think people want to find something they can relate to. So I think that also filmmaking in general, I believe the style of acting, the style of filmmaking in the last 15 years, things have become more realistic. For better or for worse, I mean, for stuff like The Dark Knight, I think, and superhero movies, it's been really positive because you have these relatable characters in kind of an unrelatable world, and it's drawn people in. And I think that that style of filmmaking, that style of acting is great, but there's also been stuff where I've been like, it's a little too casual, you know? I think it's just, you know, I think that it just kind of comes with the territory of how film and how acting has changed.
Right.
Yeah. We kind of get into, I mean, this is off the superhero things, but, you know, the idea of, like, sometimes it's too casual. You remember, like, Mumblecore?
Yeah, you know.
And it was like...
just some indie...
An indie style of filmmaking. They called it Mumblecore.
Yeah.
And they called it Mumblecore because basically people mumble. And I'm like, okay, just because you're stuttering over your lines doesn't mean I believe you. Like, that doesn't make it honest, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you'll see that with people sometimes. I've seen a lot. I mean, it comes with also television and movies becoming greater. There comes that also because people want to be like the... Because great actors, it looks like they're not acting. So other people go, oh, I just have to be super, super natural. You know, and not supernatural, but very, you know, not the show, but very natural. Sometimes it turns out to be really casual and really boring and actually not realistic. But that's just because people aren't as good as other people at really bringing that naturalistic style to filmmaking to acting.
It's such a fine line because for me personally, as an actor, I want to be as truthful as possible with whatever I'm doing. And make that connection with whoever I'm talking with, because that's what makes it special whenever you watch something, especially some good performances. It's not only are they quote-unquote natural or being extremely truthful, but also that connection that they have with whoever they're talking to, if it be their lover, their enemy, their father, mother. And it's such a fine balance because, you want to do all that, but at the same time, you have to enunciate. You have to hit your mark.
Please,
I mean, there's a little
please.
You know, there is a place for technique, I think, right? Like,
oh, absolutely. Well, look at some of like the best fighters, for instance, Jonathan. This is something you're familiar with as well. Anderson Silva, let's take him for example, in his heyday, right?
Yeah.
He looked like he wasn't even fighting sometimes. He was like, but you know that he trained for so, like, the training was like hours and hours and hours and hours. So it just seemed like it was.
Yeah,
like
he was so
was
relaxed.
Happening.
He was so calm whenever he came in. And yeah, I think that transcends acting, fighting,
right?
A lot of different arts. There's a difference between being relaxed and doing your job and just trying to BS naturalistic style. And that's my biggest, I think my biggest problem with, because I think, yes, television's getting better, but mainly television. My biggest problem with television is you'll see that half of television, you'll see, like, I believe television overall is getting better, but you'll see individuals, actors be like, you're like, what? What? Have to DVR rewind it. What? You're like, I'm sorry. it's hard to understand. And yeah, I there is something to be said for enunciating your words and speaking clearly so that people can understand you.
Yeah, it doesn't matter how honest you feel if no one knows what you're saying.
Yeah.
Well, that was actually my only problem with Batman. Like, all the whole series, I was like,
oh, yeah.
That's a big thing. Is like, yeah, do you have throat cancer now? Like, what is happening to your voice?
You know what's so funny, though?
Hey, Batman.
When I saw that for the first time, and I didn't even hear the mumbling, or like, I was just like, oh, man, this is a great film, whatever. And then when everybody started making fun of it, I'm like, guys, you guys are like, exaggerating, like it wasn't that bad. And then I went and rewatched it, and I was like, "Oh, holy shit! This is that bad." I didn't even hit me. I don't know. Maybe my experience was completely different.
I was just wondering if like Christian Bale ever gets drunk and walks down the street, and be like, "I'm Batman." Yeah. Me.
I hope not.
I'm Batman.
He's great.
No, he's great. Actually, I think that one of the things that brought those movies to be so much more real is because we are now in like a big theme now is the flawed human being, like the flawed hero of the stories.
Ah, yeah.
So I feel like we actually focus a lot more on the person as opposed to the superhero in a lot of the new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So you kind of, like, we have a different perspective of how we're telling the story.
Right. Well, I think that's also more for the audience member. They can connect more knowing that it's not like this demigod that they're watching on screen.
Yeah. I think it's easy to connect with, and it's also, I think, easier, or it's more, not easier, but it's actually probably harder, but you get more into that character as a human being, especially as an actor. Like, you get to portray that in such a more raw way.
When I saw Thor, did you guys see the first Thor?
I saw the first Thor, didn't really care for it too much.
Oh, yeah. you didn't like it either? Okay.
It felt very cheesy.
But, oh, really?
You know what I do love?
I had a different experience. See, I like when I differ, like, have a totally different experience than somebody. I love the father son relationship in there.
Mm.
I thought it was very archetypical.
I would have to see it again, to be completely honest with you. I just remember walking out and being like, this is why I don't go to superhero movies, just because I just like.
Oh, really? Okay.
I don't know.
The only one I really do love, and I feel weird saying that I like it because I don't really like Captain America as like a character. Captain America 2. Awesome.
Here it's great. I haven't seen it.
Loved it more than the Avengers. Just thought it was like actually way more of a like a realistic story.
Well, the Avengers: Age of Ultron was like, yeah. See the sequel, second Avengers.
I watched 10 minutes of it and had to shut it off because I was like, I'm just not into it.
So the first Avengers was fantastic, right? Like it's really like just like Joss Whedon.
Yes,
like,
the first one.
Blew us all away. We're like, oh my god, this is great. And then the sequel, like they got lazy. They didn't care as much. They didn't have to prove as much. And it's like that's when the films start to fall apart. Kind of like, well, if you're gonna do it right. You know,
yeah.
And like. I think all these sequels and spinoffs and this and that like are fine if they're gonna really keep upping their game,
mm-hmm.
but it tends to go the opposite way where it's like, okay, the other ones are not as good as the original, so it's like, all right, great, we did it, and then going down worse and worse, and so it's sort of like it saturates the market with all this crap, and then it doesn't leave room for like the other good stuff that could come in, and then it's just sort of like it's all mushy. So
you felt it was a little mushy.
I think all these sequels and spinoffs and this and that. I mean, there's like so many movies. Like if they're like, that's why The Dark Knight stands out so well, because like he went out and made a movie that was better than Batman Begins. Like, the sequel to Batman Begins is much better.
Mm.
Just, you know, I mean, it's an Oscar-winning movie. So that's why everyone was like, Christopher Nolan's the man, because he's really upping up his game. Where sometimes you go see like the Avengers, great, Avengers 2, not great. And sort of like, come on. Like,
yeah. Yeah. Like the first 10 minutes are like the last 15 minutes of the first film. I'm like, what's happening? Everyone's fighting. Like, I don't know. did I miss something? Or there's 20 minutes that they didn't show?
I didn't see the second one, but I think it's important for our listeners and us, and I'm sure we all remember this, but like when you're working on a big studio film like that, you know, it's not just, you know, you got studio execs,
a lot of opinion.
You know,
a lot of cooks in the kitchen.
Yeah, and so sometimes that can affect the final product.
Of course. I mean, it's sequels are about money more than the originals, almost. Sequels are really about money. That's why they make them. And so I think when you're making art and creating art and performances with money being the main driving force, I think movies suffer. Yeah. I really do. I just think when money is like the top priority of why we're doing this, which happens a lot in studio. I understand you have to make money. I get the whole thing. But like when it's like top priority, it I think the films suffer.
Yeah. Well, it's part of the game. I mean, once we accept that as actors.
Or not accept it, though. That's what I'm saying. Like, when does it change? You know, you could accept it, like, nah, it's just part of the game. Or it's like, no. Like, let's really, as artists and actors, the next generation coming in, you know, while trying to break and make our way, like, let's not do that. Let's not, you know, if we can try not to do that.
But
you
know, go ahead.
I think, you know, there's a happy medium, right? Because I think money, while it shouldn't be the main driver, that is, as a society, how we say what we think is important, is how much money we
give. Vote with your dollar.
That is, right. I mean, this is like, we live in a capitalist society, for better or for worse, right? Whatever. But that's how we deem what's important. So I think as artists, it's very important to value ourselves and value our work by making sure that we get paid, and we get paid to make the art that we want to make. So I think there's like a happy medium in there. Like art, you know, money shouldn't be the main driver, but at the same time, I have no interest in being a starving artist. Like,
no,
I'd pay my bills.
Like Jurassic World,
I don't need
for
to
example.
Be in a mansion, but I want to pay my bills.
Jurassic World's a good example of a movie that highest grossing movie of all time. Well, not Star Wars is, but before Star Wars, it was Jurassic World. And I love Jurassic Park, right? I mean, I've seen it maybe twice, three times a year for the last 20 years. I've seen it a bunch of times. I love that movie.
That's intense.
I love that movie. And Spielberg did a great job with that movie. It's grounded performances. It's real. You care about the characters. Everything's fantastic. Jurassic World feels like a studio movie, winking at the camera, tons of product placement, tons of like trying to hit all the quadrants of the audience. And like, it just feels that way. And it was the biggest disappointment of the year for me. It's still the highest grossing movie. You love Jurassic World.
You liked it?
I'm like one of those people that when I'm a dedicated fan, it could be probably really bad and I still might really love it. Oh. But I thought there was a lot that I do agree that there's a lot of like product placement. There's a lot of like,
I don't care about product placement, more about the performance
like,
of the actors.
But just like, as far as like, I just felt like some of it I can agree. It was definitely, the first one holds up to be like so true to itself. But the new one had so much to recreate the universe of the first one for a new audience that I appreciate. There's a lot of recreations of shots. There's a lot of like recreations of like, there's certain scenes that I'm
not nearly
like,
as good, right? So it's like
yeah.
What?
Yeah.
Who's your favorite character in Jurassic World?
In Jurassic World,
who's your favorite character?
I would say it's probably Bryce Dallas Howard.
What's your character name? What's her name in the movie?
That's Claire. I know that.
Claire. All
right. Hey, Jonathan.
I was trying to quote honest trailers.
Yeah,
work.
I think that I just.
But
yeah.
I think you don't care about the characters as much.
They're playing on nostalgia, is what they were playing on.
Star Wars did a better job.
Jurassic World, I felt like they had the most, and I remember you saying this, and I agreed so much when we talked about this.
He's saying Benita is right.
Yes, okay.
I want to let everybody know.
I remember you saying this when we were filming Interns of F.I.E.L.D. They underutilized the, basically, how am I going to say this? Okay, they didn't utilize having the most charming person on Earth,
true.
Chris Pratt. They didn't let him be, I feel like, what has made him a huge star. The fact that he's so charming, I think they really didn't utilize that.
Yeah.
How just naturally charming that guy is.
I think that was my biggest thing. Because, you know, I like Jurassic Park. I don't have the same nostalgia for it, but I liked it when it came out. It was a great film, like super enjoyed it, whatever. But yeah, like the character. So I was really like wanting to be invested in the characters. And I thought there was zero chemistry between them, which is sad because like as actors separately, I love Bryce Dallas Howard. I love Chris Pratt. Like they're great. And I think they made them be people that they were it, right? Like, Chris Pratt was, like, not charming. And, like, how do you even manage that? Like, yeah. I think he's so charming just naturally. And she's got kind of this energy about her that is also charming in its own way. And I think really, and they just kind of turned her into this very cold, I mean, I don't think the
they're
character
playing cliches
did her,
almost, right?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
They made her into this like cold, career-driven woman who then like turns around and suddenly by the end realizes she wants kids. So that was a whole other thing. Like, oh, great, we get another story of a sexless female who then.
I love Chris Pratt too, by the way. I mean,
Ellie kind of did. They did the same thing with Ellie from the original too. Was like she kind of like left her entire field and then went into like having children and just being a stay-at-home
mom
or something. Ellie from the original by the first at the end of the first movie, and by the time she's in the third movie, she's like stay-at-home mom or something.
But also, like those films were made how many years ago?
No, I know.
And it's like we're still
trying. It's like a little wink.
It's like not an. That's not an interesting story or perspective to tell anymore, I don't think.
I feel like everything that's coming to life that's being recreated from, like, back in the day is just, like, the same story. Like, Star Wars, love Star Wars to death, thought it was a great movie, gonna go see it again in theaters, but also, like, kind of a little bit, as much as I loved it, it's the same story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is great, they're recreating it for a whole new generation, but for the people that have previously loved it so much, it's just kind of like, you know, why are we having to watch the same thing over?
Well, I thought the cool thing about Star Wars, the one part that I thought was different was John Boyega was kind of like a dork in it. And I thought that was so charming that I felt he was so human, so realistic. And he's this guy making this crazy hard choice, you know, to go against what he's been raised to do. Mm. And I really liked that he seemed really human.
Yeah.
And he had kind of his weird little, quirks.
Yeah, and I felt like everyone else felt really human to me, too. And I think that's why I really connected with it is, you know, Rey, they let her, she was strong, but also vulnerable, but also conflicted. You know, she was a full rounded person. And I even think, what's his name?
Finn.
No.
Adam Driver.
Adam Driver. Oh, yeah.
Kylo Ren, like, he also was a real person, right? Like, I think, you know, when we had Darth Vader was just evil and dark, and he was set in his path, and that was it. And we got to see
had some breathing issues.
just really bad.
I remember in the cliff notes. Yeah.
But, you know, Kylo Ren has conflicts. He's conflicted by this, and I loved that. I thought that was super interesting.
Humanizing the bad guy.
What do you guys think about the Han Solo spinoff? Who do you think should play Han Solo?
Well,
Jonathan Lipnicki.
I was gonna say Wee Sam Keesh. I was gonna say Wee Sam Keesh.
Let's both do it.
A buddy.
don't let that be the worst spinoff.
Two of them, and then they combined to be one.
It's a buddy comedy.
If you want to see young Han Solo, though, you watch the original Star Wars, right? It's a buddy sound. Like, yeah, that's young Han Solo. So, like, you already have a young Han Solo.
Oh, boy, is he dreamy in this.
I'm actually going to see Star Wars today.
First time?
First time.
Okay.
Oh.
Let's discuss the ending right now.
Is that the new ones?
No, I saw the other ones in order. Like, when episode one came out, that was the first Star Wars film I saw.
Wow.
And then I went through them.
You'll fun. You'll enjoy it. It's fun.
Will I?
If you saw all six, I'm not a big Star Wars fan.
I thought you were being sarcastic for a second.
No, I think you'll enjoy it. Like,
oh, okay.
I watched the original three in anticipation, and then I was like, well, if I watch these three, I'll go back and watch. Fell asleep within 20 minutes of the first movie.
Oh,
Phantom
yeah.
Menace is just like, oh my god, I cannot get.
I love the Phantom Menace,
but it's just
really?
Like
we should just pretend it never happened.
I don't, you know, I don't hate the fan. Like, I appreciate that it's there. But it's just like, I'm not gonna.
I just think
watch
so many good movies are overlooked though because of all this stuff, right? Because all super. I mean, it's like Ex Machina was best movie, one of the best movies of the year. Straight Outta Compton. The End of the Tour is my personal favorite, and like I just think like a lot of these movies like just unfortunately like get lost in the shuffle of the big stuff.
Mm. You know what? The Darth Maul fight scene with Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon Jinn is that the right way to say it?
You're asking the wrong guy here.
Liam Neeson. We'll just say Liam Neeson.
That sounds right.
Yeah. Liam Neeson. No, like, technically, it's not that complicated of a fight scene. I don't know if you remember it, Jonathan.
All I know is Liam has his special set of skills, so, you know.
And a daughter.
Like, oh, my gosh.
I'll find you and
no,
I'll kill you.
I don't know. It's not a really technical fight scene, but it's just so intense because I specifically remember being in the theater and when, you know, the double red lightsaber comes out. Everybody's like, oh shit,
there's two of them.
Did you hear the big theory though that they came out with? Well, it's not a theory, I guess they confirmed it, but he chickened out. It was supposed to be, I wanted to watch that movie because right before break they said, or Christmas break, they had announced that, what was it, Jar Jar Binks was actually a Sith Lord that was working on the dark side. And if you watch the first movie, he's implanting everything into Anakin's head to not, like, basically being like, Qui-Gon's a total douchebag, don't listen to him. Like, because he's completely... And then he was supposed to be, like, the Sith Yoda. And they were supposed to do a whole fight scene in the second movie. It was, like, this whole big conspiracy that he was supposed to be bigger, but everyone was just like, we hate him. So he was like, all right, never mind. Sorry, guys.
Wait, this is real?
Interesting.
Yeah, this is supposed to be, like, a real thing. Like I believe George Lucas said that it was supposed to do that, and then he just like was like, oh, everybody hated him, so we dropped the entire story. I don't know if that was like a, maybe that's a hoax, I don't know. I thought it was a real thing, though.
Do you guys have a lot of Star Wars fans watching this, by the way?
Yeah, we've got all different.
We've been talking about this for a while. Yeah. I think we need to
I hope you're still watching.
or listening. Oh, yeah. I mean, we've gone on weirder tangents on here.
Yeah.
Well, anyway.
Sorry for that. I was just like, are we talking about, for 20 minutes,
Joe.
Star Wars. Star Wars is good, but this is the problem with the film industry I'm talking about. It takes all our energy and distraction away. I mean, I don't even care.
Joe, that was the best moment.
I love you guys.
Okay, Interns of F.I.E.L.D. Sundays at 10 a.m. Pacific time.
Hashtag interns in bed, 10 a.m. Sunday.
Actually, we are at the break, and when we come back, I'll have some interesting questions to ask you guys.
Awesome.
Ooh.
Yeah. We'll be right back. I love
it. For decades, they've been lying to you. While you sleep safe at night, there's a war going on. A war that only we can stop. But it wasn't always this way. I remember when, as a girl, all I ever wanted was to...
Are you doing an origin story?
What? No, I was...
From the creators of Honest Trailers comes a show about superheroes. Assistants.
Interns, assemble!
What's our mission, sir?
Yeah, the cool part is over with, so, clean up all this crap.
Superheroes are cool.
Who wants to watch me shoot stuff?
Interns are neat.
Doesn't Tor fly? Why does he take so many Ubers?
Guys, what are you doing? We have to get out of here.
Playing a delightful telephone game where colorful animals murder other colorful animals.
I had superpowers, or a gun, or a hammer, or really strong strength.
If I could shoot icicles out of my hand, or a web, or if I had velociraptor powers.
You'd all be so sorry right now.
Interns, clean up the dead guy.
Interns of F.I.E.L.D.
Quit staring, nerds.
We're back with Sean Penn in the studio. Sean, thanks for joining. Oh, he's not?
He's just off in the corner.
Benita.
Yeah.
I hear you want to talk about Sean Penn?
Oh, yeah. It's fascinating to talk about it.
No, that guy's, seriously, though, that's very dangerous. He's like, his life is in danger, though, for real.
Can I get a brief summary? Because I'm a little out of the loop on this.
Sean Penn caught El Chapo. Yeah.
Let that be a t-shirt, please.
Yeah.
So apparently, and please, guys, if I'm saying any of this wrong, let me know. They had a connection to get an invitation to meet El Chapo with this Latina journalist. Am I correct?
No. Spanish? She wasn't a journalist. She's
actress.
She's an actress. I think she does like telenovelas.
Yeah,
I think.
Exactly.
Okay. And by the way, footnote, El Chapo kind of had an obsession with her, and it was like a little weird. I don't know if it was weird or not. I don't want the cartel to. I don't know. This is what I'm reading. So they met him at a secure location in the jungle, and he wanted to have a dialogue with El Chapo about the war on drugs. And that didn't really happen. So, and then shortly after, El Chapo got caught. And so they did the interview with Sean Penn. Did you see the Nightline? The
Charlie Nightline? Rose thing, 60 Minutes?
Yeah, yeah. Did you see that?
No, I
saw, I saw see part it. Of it. I don't, is the whole thing out already?
I saw part of it on...
It's a six-minute clip on the morning show, but I can't remember.
Did they say they're going to possibly prosecute him?
Possibly. I he's a fugitive. I mean, I don't think that's legal to meet with a person like that, right?
Yeah, you know, I don't know if it's legal. I just find the whole... God, it's just, it wasn't a good interview.
I haven't read it yet. Is it not a good interview?
No, it's not. It's much more about Sean Penn. And look, I'm a huge Sean Penn fan. I think he's a fantastic actor. I could watch him all day, but it's just not a good interview. It's like most of it is spent about like how he gets there and what's he feeling. And it's just, and the questions he asks are just super bland and uninteresting.
Are they prosecuting him for a bad interview?
I think that's what they're doing. They're like, Rolling Stone, you're just done. Sean Penn, don't do this again.
But in all fairness, having to interview someone like that, I think you'd be scared to go really deep.
Yeah, but then why did the interview in the first place?
I think he probably thought he would be less scared than he was. I mean, you're going into a room with
Well, yeah. So here's the thing.
His name shouldn't be mentioned.
Yeah,
I'm Voldemorting him, right? I'm Voldemorting him, right? I'm scared of him, and he's...
He's gone.
Well, I like his intentions, though. I mean, I don't know much about it. But what I do know is that he was trying to bring a dialogue to the conversation. He's about, you know, Republican, Democrat, whatever side of the line, whatever you're... Like, your kids are out there... maybe doing drugs and supporting all of this chaos. And so it's a bigger issue than just capturing El Chapo or whatever. It's much bigger than that. It's the drug culture is what's creating all this chaos and murder and death. And like, I think it's an interesting thing to put a spotlight on.
But that's not, okay, but that's not what was addressed. And
I haven't read it yet.
Was he talking about how Sean Penn felt in the interview?
Yeah, so this was my main issue with it, was like, it was just not a good interview, but the condition under which he got the interview was that El Chapo got final approval. So like, what no journalist would ever give final approval, or if he was, then the byline should have been for El Chapo. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It should have been like El Chapo, my story, or whatever. Like, to say it's Sean Penn, but he gets the final say. And when it came down to talking about the drug culture, it was really El Chapo's voice on why he didn't. It's like, we all know as storytellers that villains never think themselves villains, right? He's like, well, you know, I came from a poor area and I had no other way to make money, which might have well been true, but not at all addressing the larger consequences of his actions, right? He really loves his mom. Like, that's what we learned. Like, we learned nothing interesting.
Okay, Actors Anonymous, we're sending Benita down to interview El Chapo. You heard it here first. Sending her on a trip. Please donate to our GoFundMe.
If we're going to all read in the news that like one of us keeps getting picked off.
Oh, God. No. No, also, I have nothing personal against El Chapo. I just think Sean Penn did not do a good interview.
I don't know. It's just, I don't think, it's just such a dangerous circumstance. And I don't know if it's really worth it in the end. Because you have kids. Sean Penn has kids. Yeah. He has a family. And I don't know. I think there might have been a better approach to it without having to maybe meet El Chapo.
Skype.
Jordan.
FaceTime.
Send each other snaps.
FaceTime. Yeah. Just Snapchat interviews. Is it Ecuador that was like, he like literally has been, he holds like Saturday sessions or like where he's live on TV and he'll literally just like read out mean tweets and like call people out being like, you're a jerk. Like,
that's amazing.
People send stuff, like post stuff about him and he like goes after them live in front of a live audience.
Oh my God.
Of like his entire people.
Who does?
I think it's the I believe it's the president of Ecuador. I'm pretty
sure. Oh, he reads celebrity. I read the president. And I was like, Obama? Wrong,
yeah.
Obama does this weekly.
He does do mean tweets. He's done mean tweets, I believe. But no, it's like he like calls people out. Like, I'm like, don't you have better things to do? You're running a country.
That is
pretty hilarious.
But he's like a baby about it, though. Right? I think he's like literally just like, and then I think, this is John Oliver, I think, was like, messaging him, like saying that everyone should like message really awful things to him.
I don't know, people, I'm not comparing the two, but you know, those people who have great power, like let's say the North Korean leader Kim Jong-un or Il Un?
Ill was his dad.
Okay. So it's Un. I had jet lag for a while, so I'd stay up like in the middle of the night for hours just watching like not documentary footage, but like footage from North Korea about North Korea.
Terrifying.
Oh, I had jet lag. But by the way, I saw.
Okay, I get it now.
That makes sense. I had no comment on Jurassic World because I saw it on a 16-hour flight from Abu Dhabi. So I was just like half dazed and half not awake, you know, watching it. And so I was like, oh, by the way, that's what I wanted to ask. And I need to find an answer to this. How did the dinosaur not be able to be detected by the heat camera? You guys know what I'm talking about?
Oh, because he did the thing where he was like invisible, but there were
he may be able to control his body temperature too.
Okay, that was not clear to me in the film, and I'm like, wait, did I miss something? And no. I didn't rewind it, and so I was questioning that for about an hour into the film.
Yeah,
and I
might have missed a lot of stuff. She was in heels for that entire movie.
She was?
Yeah.
I did not notice.
There's
that.
Actually a really funny YouTube video of like
running away from the T-Rex.
We're re-releasing the footage and everything's in high heels, like the T-Rex is in high heels running around. You just hear like all the dinosaurs are running. It's like click. It's unfortunate.
But back to North Korea. Those guys are crazy. Even if you're on their good side, you never know when they're gonna flip and stuff like that.
Yeah.
That's all I wanted to say. There you go.
That's why I'm not going
Joe,
to North Korea.
That's all I wanted to say. Man.
I love that you said it. One of us had to.
North Korea.
Boo.
Benita, they're watching.
Guys, on Interns of F.I.E.L.D., and maybe if you guys can give us a little teaser. If not, that's totally fine, but maybe a hint at it.
Well, I got a scene for you.
What's that?
Well, I got a clip right now.
Oh, really?
I'm kidding.
No, okay.
Got it.
Do any of you guys get a little taste of superpowers throughout the thing?
It's a good question.
Maybe.
Okay.
Maybe not.
But maybe.
Okay, not. That's fair. I know what it's asking actors questions about spoilers through, but yeah. I just want to hear a maybe or maybe not. So
without spoilers, can you tell us about your characters?
Yeah, sure. So my character is Skylar Murphy, and she's new to the team. She's there. She wants to be an agent. She's very driven, right, and motivated, and she is going to get to the top, and she loves this world, and she's just completely idolized these people, so she's just like super excited.
Cool. Jonathan?
Hi, I'm Jonathan Lipnicki. I play Chaz.
Finally, the intro we've been waiting for.
Yeah, Chaz Furry, who is the stepson of Rick Furry, who runs F.I.E.L.D., and I don't want to be there. You know, my stepdad runs the place. I do as little as possible, and I'm kind of a dick.
Okay. Good to know.
Yeah.
Good to know.
I play the character Fish. I'm sort of the nerd of the bunch who loves being an intern at the office, not Marvel, but working for the Revengers. Wants to, El Chapo, Star Wars.
North Korea,
Star Wars, Chapo, just don't listen to me. He's really passionate, excited about his job, and he wants to get promoted to be an agent someday, and he's just so giddy about the whole experience and really wants to do a good job of, you know, working there. And he does care. He's the opposite of Chaz, and they have a little bit of a back and forth. Chaz likes to pick on Fish. Yeah. But hey, Johnny.
That wasn't the finger. That was the knuckle, right?
Yeah.
I was hoping for the finger, but I only got the.
That's what she said.
This is going to be very confusing for the podcast listeners.
That's okay.
A wet willy.
Put your pants back.
Wait, what? We're all naked, by the way.
Yeah, no one's wearing pants underneath this.
How did you know? Jordan's cheating.
Is the first episode is up on Screen Junkies.
Yeah,
is it released on YouTube as well soon? Or
so what they're planning on doing is we think so far. So
this is an inside tip, by the way. So this is for the listeners. Get an inside tip here from Benita.
Yeah. So the first three episodes will come out on Screen Junkies Plus, and then at that time the first episode, so when the third episode premieres, the first episode will be made available on the Screen Junkies YouTube channel. So people get a taste, because now, if you're not a subscriber, you've only seen the trailer, which is awesome, but it's not one of those trailers where they put all the jokes in and tell you the whole story.
Oh, it's still hilarious. I totally got the premise. I was like, dude, this is going to be really funny.
The pilot, though, I think is just as far as the level of funny is way, way more funny than the trailer, which, I mean, they didn't want to put all the jokes in.
Yeah.
And that's great. So, but I think it's important that people see the pilot, because then they'll want to watch more.
Well, also, a little, you know, message to our listeners. It's only $5 a month to subscribe to the Screen Junkies website, right?
After your free trial. So if you go to the website, sign up, it's 3 months free.
And then $5 a month, which is nothing. And also, as an artist, as a creative, as an actor, you should be able to spare $5 a month to support a group of people doing some really amazing work. And I that's one of my New Year's resolutions is, you know what? I don't ever want to be, I don't know if finicky is the right word, or fickle, excuse me, with like money. Like, oh, I don't want to pay for the subscribership for this thing. No, I'm going to pay, support the artists, support the creatives, because I believe that comes back to you as well.
It does.
Nice. Yeah.
And so I really urge our listeners, hey, if you like the trailer, if you like what Screen Junkies has done, if you've watched their stuff before in the past, hey, give them a little thank you, subscribe, and you won't be disappointed.
It's a fun show, and you know, they're
a lot of fun shows.
You know, they gave us a subscription, being part of the cast for a little trial. And I actually been using it a lot. I actually been following a lot of the shows. They have shows called Movie Fights where they debate movies. They have a bunch of other shows. They have another show called Movie Games that we're actually going to be on in a couple weeks.
Right.
And it's fun. If you're a movie fan and you're kind of into like movie conversations, they offer a lot. And then with this new original content, Interns of F.I.E.L.D., the first one, it's a really fun show. They're going to be doing hopefully many more original content shows. And like Benita was saying, like Silicon Valley did on when Silicon Valley first came out, they put the first episode on YouTube for free, just to get HBO, just to get people hooked on the show. So in a few weeks, hush hush, but the pilot will be out, I think, for free, so people can at least taste it before they purchase it.
Well, we'll definitely push it.
Please do.
Yeah.
Podcast. We're really
proud of it.
Thank you so much.
You guys should be proud of it. Anytime any actors or creatives get to put their work out there, I definitely think you know.
And Screen Junkies is definitely push. Yeah, and they're good. They're smart. They really know how to like poke the holes at the Marvels. Yeah. They know what they're doing. You know, they're really funny writers.
And since this is an actor podcast, you're talking about not being fickle with money. I think it's really important that you prioritize as an actor, as an artist who maybe doesn't have the most money at this time.
Right.
Prioritize where you spend your money, and if it's on, you should spend your money on what you want to do. And if you know, acting is your career, filmmaking is your career, spending it on Hulu Plus subscriptions or Netflix subscriptions is a great way, because you got to educate yourself on material that's out there, and you also have to support other artists.
That
also
is one
tax
of
deductible.
Right. That is one of the things my management team has also said to me, and other managers, whenever they have new clients come in, like as perspective, like, hey, we might rep you or we might work together as a team. They ask them questions like, hey, what shows are you watching now that are on now? Mm-hmm. Not like, oh, I see myself, you know, being like, you know, like somebody on Friends or The Office. It's like, wait, those shows have been over for a while. What shows are you working on now? So with all the different venues, you know, like you said, Hulu Plus, Amazon, Netflix, even like CBS, I believe, is doing a subscribership thing soon, or
everything's kind of going this way.
HBO Go.
I mean, we can list on and on and on.
It gets pricey though too.
What's that?
It gets pricey too. You start doing $5 here, $10 there. I mean, it gets pricey.
Yes, but if you have like other actor friends, you can maybe split it. And I don't know if that's kosher to do with some of the subscription. I'm sure you can.
HBO Go is really cool. HBO Go is like kind of like, we know everyone's sharing our password and it's fine. Like HBO Go is like kind of like whatever. Just watch our stuff. And I love that about them. Like, they're really chill about it.
That's the big thing about online right now, though, is that the like online everything is generally used to be free, and now like what we're doing is getting advanced screening of it, so it's kind of like to avoid being spoiled or whatever, and also just to be able to watch everything in the best possible format. They're releasing it so that you do need the subscriptions, but it's worth a few bucks to do it, like instead of waiting for another month where, you know, you're going to be out of the loop.
Also, and I have been guilty of this in the past, but, you know, a lot of times when we want to watch our favorite show or we want to download a movie, sometimes we won't go the most kosher routes to do so. I strongly suggest, I've been doing this, just go on iTunes and just buy it.
Yeah.
It's only a few bucks. It's not going to kill you. It's not going to, like, make a huge dent at all on your bank account. And it's easier. You have a direct download. It's safer. And you're supporting, again, other artists and creatives. As you all know, the circle of creatives and artists and actors and producers and filmmakers and so on and so forth, and everybody involved behind the scenes and at the post-production and in editing, such a small group of family. And so, like, you're taking a little bit away from them every time you do that. And it's one of my New Year's resolutions that I'm trying to push.
That's great, man. I appreciate hearing that.
Build each other up. You know, I think that if the more support we show for each other and the more that we buy these subscriptions or, you know, support things that are coming out like Screen Junkies Plus, the more, if they do well, there's more opportunities for more actors to do more scripted shows. So don't shoot yourself in the foot because you might be auditioning for something that Screen Junkies Plus does. Yeah. But if you don't support them and they have to, you know, and they can't have that streaming service any longer, then there's going to be, you know, those opportunities aren't going to be there.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, and, you know, I think we were saying earlier, it's like you vote with your dollars, right? Mm-hmm. And so if you see something you really love, go see it in theaters. Go, pay for that subscription because that's what the companies see. That's what the corporations see. Oh, okay, we got this many viewers. We have this many subscribers, this many people. You know, these were our box office numbers. They're going to make more content like that because at the end of the day, like, love it or hate it, our culture revolves around money.
You know, this is something also that's been resonating with me, and because of the whole Powerball thing that just happened recently. Did anybody buy tickets, by the way?
I did. Yeah.
I actually won it, but I didn't want to tell you.
Oh, that's fair. Yeah. That's fair.
Wait, do you think the nurse up in California, the one that won apparently, and now they're saying it was a prank, her son pranked her.
No.
Do you think the story that came out saying it was a prank is just to protect her?
Yeah, right.
Because I think she won. It was covering all the news, but now they're saying, oh, it was a prank. Her son called her at work and said she won. When I'm like, how would that be what would validate it to begin with? So I'm kind of waiting for her protection because I'm sure she got bombarded. They're like, oh, it's a prank. She doesn't want all this attention.
I hope that's the story too.
I hope she won.
You know what's bullcrap? In the state of California, you have to, you can't be anonymous if you win the lottery.
Is that really?
I'm like, dude. Why is that a rule? Like, that you put somebody's life in danger.
Seriously.
Whenever you publicly announce that, hey, I have $300 million cash in the bank now.
Right.
You can find out where I live pretty easily.
Well, they said where she works. They said that she was, she knows, everything about her. Where she lives, where she works.
Like, why are you doing that?
Can't walk to her car.
Yeah.
Anyway. Movie rights.
That's me.
That's why.
Hire private security detail. Definitely invest in that after winning the lottery, guys.
What you were saying, though, earlier about voting with your dollars, you said? Is that what you said? Voting, okay. We have to remember that when we pass on, we're not able to transfer our bank accounts into the next life. And so I know as actors, as artists, as creatives, money is a big problem sometimes. It's a big burden sometimes. But the things that have helped me relieve a lot of that stress, sometimes it helps a little bit, sometimes it helps a lot, is realizing that when I'm being of service, when I'm being a good person, when I'm being a good impact, a positive impact to my fellow artists, man, it makes me feel better. It makes me feel, okay, you know what? There's more substance to my life. I'm not always thinking about, oh, I need to do this. I need to get money. I need to get money to pay the bills. I need to do this to get the bills. No, there's something more to life than that. And there really is. And sometimes it's hard, especially when you're in the shit and you have debt, student debt, which fucking blows my mind. So whenever you do those little things like Screen Junkies, you go on there. You know what? You go, you know what? I love what they're doing. They make me laugh. Boom. Here's $5 a month. I hope to see more good content. I don't know. It just makes me feel like whenever you're like, and whenever you buy the lotto ticket, you know, you're like, great, if I win, if not, that's fine. But I'm like mentally, I'm thinking, you know what? I'm paying this $10 for these 5 tickets for the education in this state because I know it needs help. So there you go.
On the flip side, I agree with all that. One thing that's been this is great because we're talking to actors. I feel like actors are having to cough up too much money in the beginning of their careers out here with the casting workshops, which I think are overpriced. And I think that they're, you have to pay to get auditions, and some actors are going to a lot of these per week, and every time they meet with an agent or a manager, anyway, everyone's like, gotta get new headshots. I mean, every actor friend I talk to who's like sort of like in the early stages of the career is like, yeah, I have to get new headshots, I'm like, you just had new headshots. Like, what do you, it's just like, they're dropping so much money in headshots and casting workshops, and I think it kind of breaks my heart, because I think they're spending a lot of money on these things.
You know, I think casting workshops are interesting. I've actually never done one, heard of someone having a lasting good impression from someone.
Really? I have.
Yeah?
Yeah, I had a friend who went in, was it Jeff Greenberg for Modern Family? And he ended up, they brought him in after the casting workshop for Modern Family and end up booking it.
Sure. It happens. I just think they're expensive.
Yeah. That's fair in terms of pricing. Sorry. Are we good, Nicole? On my camera? Okay. Sorry, I just hit it.
Stop doing that. I can't stop doing it.
I'm getting worked up here. No. In terms of headshots, and we've talked about it before on the show, a lot of actors, when they go in to do the headshots, sometimes it's hard for actors to get a decent headshot. You're smiling at me. You know what I'm talking about?
I've had a lot of headshots, and I've never taken... There's someone always has some sort of issue with it at some point.
Right.
It's like, all right. Whatever.
I think before you go into it, if you get headshots done, right, in hopes of... And you're spending, like, what? Like $350. That's a decent amount of change for a headshot, right?
Good average price.
Sure. Good average price, $350. And you're like, okay, I'm going to have these headshots so these agents can take a look at my stuff. So you have these meetings with these agents, and then you go in there, and let's say one agent goes, you know what, I see you as the best friend, you know, like the charming, you know, just a friendly guy. Yeah. And then you go into another meeting, and they're like, you know what, I see you more as like the nerdy tech geek, really into your work, you know, a little bit true and stuff like that. And so they're going to be like, you know what, these headshots aren't matching this. So you're going to need some new ones if we want. So of course, there's so many factors that play into that. And as actors starting off, unfortunately, there's no guidebook, right? When you enter LA, there's no like little acting.
And there's a lot of them, but you can't trust them all.
And people are trying to make money off these young actors who don't know any better. I think there's a lot of profiting off them. I don't like that.
Well, also a lot of companies, also, I mean, I can't speak for all the companies, but I know there's a lot of them that have ties to certain photographers. So they'll ask you, oh, you should go get your new headshot so that you kind of keep each other in business of like...
Right. It's like Vegas. Everyone's working together just to get the to get the guy from out of town to drop money everywhere. You know,
all the people just walking around.
I don't know what the solution is right now, but I know there is a lot of factors that play into that, especially with headshots.
I don't want to say trick, but I think one thing that's really important that when people first start out acting or they first come to LA, I mean, I think this was definitely true for myself, right? You're kind of relying on other people mm-hmm. to tell you who you are mm-hmm. and what they see you as. And I think as you kind of progress in your career, that sort of falls away and you know who you are and you know who you play and you know what characters you identify with. So for example, I just went in to get some new headshots because my headshots were like 3 years old. Like it was time.
And I also love, by the way, that I respect that you kept your old headshots on IMDb since I've known you. And I like that. You're not changing every week or, you know, some people are like, headshots. I like that you found one you liked and you have a career going.
Well, thank you.
Well, it probably still looks like her too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, well, I sleep in an oxygen chamber at night, so I don't need it. It's pretty nice. So I got new headshots and I had one very specific note from my agents and managers, which was I needed to look prettier in my headshots. They were like, no, but they meant it as a compliment. I get it. They were like, you kind of look like maybe the best friend a little bit in your pictures, but you come in and you look like a leading lady. So, you know.
That's fair.
No, which is totally fair.
We have to realize that this is a marketing thing. Absolutely.
I'm fine with that. I appreciate it. But it's just kind of funny to be like, you're much, you know, you're prettier in real life. Your pictures, you're not so pretty in your pictures.
You look like the crypt keeper in this.
So, no, I get it, and I appreciate it, and obviously, I love my agents and managers, and I think they do a great job specifically for that reason, because we have a relationship where they can tell me that. But that's a very general note to go in and tell a photographer, right? So I was able to go into the photographer, and I love my new headshots, Dana Patrick Photography. If anyone
wants to go. I was just looking at her stuff.
Yeah. Oh, she's fantastic. Yeah. Super great to shoot with. Anyways, I went in and she said, okay, like, what are the notes? And I was like, they want me to be prettier. And she's like, okay. And then I was able to go in and say, these are the type of roles I play and connect with. And this is who this woman is. You know, and I wasn't having to say, well, you know, my agent kind of thinks I'm this. Maybe, you know, like, I knew who I was. And I think as you progress through your career and you just are more knowledgeable about yourself, like that's where the power comes from. And that's, I think, where people can't take advantage of you as much that way because they're like, well, I see you like this. And it's like, well, I'm not that. Okay, maybe we're not a great fit because you don't see me the way I really am.
Sure.
So cool, we're not going to fit. No problem.
I echo what you're saying and I agree with it. to a certain point. There is some people, though, out there right now, and I'll go back to the first part where you were talking about. A lot of people who've been out here for years, they're like, no, I'm – they have that – they're stuck in that mentality. Mm-hmm. Like, no, I play like this. No, I am this. I am this. I am mm-hmm. this. It's mm-hmm. like, dude, you are not that. Mm. Trust me. Like, I know you really want to be that, which is fine, and you could possibly play it, but, like, looks-wise, you don't fit that. So I think it's important for all actors, all creatives, to have that awareness, like, okay – it's been going on for like 4 years now.
Yeah, yeah.
I have like different people telling me the same thing. Let's reevaluate. I think that's crucial to do.
Oh, absolutely.
It's about knowing your brand. It's about, I don't think people treat something enough like acting enough as a business. Like I think you have to, you know, your look or your stature or like whatever it is about you, like if you cooked Italian as a chef your entire life, you're not going to go be a sushi chef.
Right.
Like, know what your brand is and, like, map out how you can move that forward.
Right.
And if I may, real quick.
Yeah, please, please.
Do a lot of young actors listen to this who are kind of starting off a little bit?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so.
We got a whole range of listeners for the show, so it's not just
Star
actors.
Star Wars fans.
Star Wars fans.
Yeah.
Young actors.
We got North Koreans.
El Chapo's listening in right now.
I don't know. Number one in North Korea, I'm just saying. Go ahead.
Anytime I talk to an actor who's sort of like, you know, how do I get more stuff in my reel? How do I kind of play more role and stuff? And, like, you know, obviously, like, you know, student films is a quick go-to answer. But I will say, AFI, if you don't know us already, if you're listening, if you're in SAG, you can join the SAG Conservatory, which is an extra, I think, $20 for the whole year, 12 months. And it's $20 for the whole year, and that makes you eligible to be in all the casting books at AFI, which is a great grad school for film here in Hollywood. And they are required to cast their films, at least in the first year. All directors do 3 films the first year. 28 directors are required to cast out of these SAG Conservatory headshot books. So if you're like, I want to get involved with some student films, but I also want to work with some people maybe who are got some good voices and who are actually finishing these projects.
Great.
Go to AFI. You can go to the casting office at AFI and talk to them, or call SAG and say I want to get into SAG Conservatory, and then go to AFI and do this. And sign up for that. Get your headshot in the casting books. And all these grad students are casting out of these books. These are great directors who are making films that are going to end up going to Sundance, South by, other film festivals in the next couple of years.
Because I've been in one of them.
So they're great. So like, and you're not going to get paid, but they're like 3 to 4 day shoots. And what's good about it is you can start to experiment. What is your brand? Mm-hmm. Audition for these different characters. So you may not know, but like if you can go to these school and maybe get cast in 2, 3, 4 films in 12 months and play a couple different characters, you can kind of start to get a taste of like, what do I excel at? What are people seeing me at? What am I getting recast as? And also get footage for your reel. So SAG Conservatory, AFI, if you're looking, I really highly recommend that.
That's really good advice.
The film Catherine Dent. She was in AFI Women's Directing Program.
Great.
And I was lucky enough to be in one of her.
Great experience, right?
It was one of the best short films I've ever shot in my life. One of the best projects I've ever been on. And I definitely recommend it. Thank you for saying that.
Of course.
Joe. Yeah. Real quick, we've got a little bit of time left, but we got to wrap it up. I just wanted to hit on, just echo what you were saying. Whenever you meet with your reps and you guys are on the same page about what you're going, like what you can go in as, when you go do headshots is the best tip I ever gotten. When I go in there, I know like, okay, these are the type of roles I know I'm going in for constantly. So, and it's immediately off my look, like they can read that. So when I go in and do the headshots, I'm not thinking in the back of my mind, I'm like, okay, I gotta be like the really like the tech geek again or something like that. You know, okay, this is me as a tech. No, just be yourself.
Yeah.
And just smile, have a good time, relax, just be yourself.
'Cause 100%.
That's what, when that clicked with me, I was like, oh my gosh, that makes a lot, all the stress is gone. And then when they're looking through the photos, they're like, oh man, these are great. Because you're not like,
this is me being brooding.
Right?
And for auditions, like when you go for the auditions, be yourself. And also like, I really think, make a choice that isn't in the script. Make a choice that isn't in the script.
Love that.
Just make a choice of something interesting that, you know, put your writer cap on for a second and just make a choice that's not on the sides in your audition.
Guys, we are wrapping up. But before we go, I know you guys have some other projects other than Interns of F.I.E.L.D. you're working on. Joe, you're working actually with a project.
Yeah, Benita, that's where we met a couple years ago on a film. awesome. Called Dependence Day. It's a little independent relationship comedy. Really excited about it. Comes out in March, where we'll be premiering at a festival. I can't, I guess, say which one yet, but yeah, comes out this year. So look out for it.
And House Sitting.
And then I wrote and directed a short film called House Sitting that I'm just finishing now. That I also acted in, my first time directing and acting. It's something I've done simultaneously, and I'm really proud of it. Waiting to hear back for some festivals as well in March and May,
awesome.
Yeah, March, April, May. Yeah.
Well, we'll keep an eye out in case it's on iTunes. Or
yeah,
on
and also, web, so yeah, my website, joeburke.net, my name.net, joeburke.net. You can watch some of my short films and stuff there if you want to see what you're up to, or awesome. Follow me on Twitter and Instagram at joeburkefilm.
Awesome. Benita, you're working on... we're part of the MTV family, by the way.
Are you?
I'm on MTV's Awkward.
Oh, are you?
Yeah.
Oh, so that's, nice. Yeah, I'm an MTV fan. I know some people on that show. Yeah, I am on Teen Wolf. I play Deputy Clark, Deputy Valerie Clark.
Nice.
Yeah, check it out. Teen Wolf Tuesdays, 9 p.m. Yeah, and the season pretty much just started. We're on the third episode, so you still have time to catch up.
Yay, awesome. And Mr. Jonathan Lipnicki, thanks for coming back on the show, dude.
I love you guys. I just want to put that out there to everybody that I love you guys.
Oh, thanks, man.
Everyone in this room.
Can you put your pants back on, please?
We'll do it when we stop rolling.
Okay.
By the way, House Sitting, saw that.
Yeah.
His film, phenomenal.
Thank you.
So impressed. Not shocked because I knew he was a talented guy, but very impressed.
Oh, thanks, buddy.
Very good. Very good short.
Well, thank you very much.
Awesome. And again, Interns of F.I.E.L.D., Screen Junkies. You get the first 3 months free.
Yeah, just
amazing.
Check it out. Please
just check it out.
It's really fun, honestly.
It's going to make you feel good.
And again, the pilot's going to be out for free in 2 weeks, so just...
No, sign up. Sign up.
Sign up.
Just sign up.
Sign up. Tweet me that you signed up, and I will follow you on Twitter.
Hey, there we go. That's a promise you can keep.
If that means anything to anybody anywhere, probably not.
I'm going to sign up today, and then you better follow me.
Yeah.
Wait for that follow button.
Yeah.
Johnny, follow me. Follow
she did that every day on set. She's like, Johnny.
It's a great show. Really funny. These guys at Screen Junkies really are doing some interesting creative stuff.
Just as a side note, I kind of know Scott. Scott Beat. What's his last name?
Bacula.
No.
Vayner.
Vayner?
I don't know.
I got so uncomfortable for a second. I was looking at the only, like, I was like, Scott Beaner?
Scott.
I like you're looking at the only Latin person in the room.
Scott B.
It was so uncomfortable. I couldn't pull away from you. I was like,
how red you're getting. Scott Mayo.
Scott Mayo. I'm sorry.
Scott B. Let's go Scott B.
Scott B.
Very talented, lovely guy.
He knows Travis Dixon, my roommate, and I've seen him a couple times. I saw him on his Applebee's or Chili's commercial run that he had for a while.
He's hilarious.
He's funny. So funny on the show.
Yeah, he's really good.
I love his
Oh, yeah. He's hilarious.
So funny.
Guys, thanks again for coming on.
Dude, thank you.
I had a blast with you guys.
Appreciate it.
Anytime you guys have stuff, hit us up. We'll definitely push it and plug it in for you guys. You guys are awesome. Jordan. Another year with you.
I know.
And it's great that you guys do this.
Are you ready?
I think this is great.
Oh, thanks, man.
I really do. I think this is an important platform, and I think it's hopefully people are listening and getting some stuff from like how to kind of, you know, approach this crazy business that we're all in.
We're going to have so many North Korean actors after this. Yeah.
That's the goal. That's the whole point.
We're bridging a gap.
That's
Chappo. Chappo's going to go get his headshots after this, actually.
He's going to be like, I know who I am.
I know who I am.
I think he just got a new one like last week, so I think he's good. All right, it's the coffee talking.
Oh, gosh. What a great first episode to kick off the year. Thanks to our listeners. You guys are awesome. Check us out on iTunes and our Twitter. Were you going to say something, Benita? Oh, no. I thought you were like you had something else. Jordan, where can they find you?
At Jordan Burbank 7
at on Jordan.
Twitter.
Big thanks to GVB Radio. Gabe, thanks for everything that you do. Good to see you again.
He's somewhere. He
can hear us in the other room. Yeah. He's like on the computer doing magical things. That was a weird thing to say. Nikki, how are you doing?
She doesn't have a mic.
Oh, she doesn't have a mic. She says she's good.
Nikki at 592.
That's right. You can find her there. And my Twitter is at WeSamKeesh. Thank you again to all our listeners. We're so excited for this year. We have some big things for you, some big giveaways, acting books. We're just going to be giving away free acting books. That's what I've decided to our listeners who chime into our contest. This is news to you? Good. I don't care. Check us out and always remember to listen, think, and then talk.